Have you seen this film?
No.
Have you heard of this film?
No.
Are you more interested in seeing this film now you know that it's been voted for by so many people?
Not really.
Spike, great to be talking to you.
How you doing?
You once said, "I ain't Martin Luther King. I don't need a dream. I have a plan." How would you characterize your plan?
Well, I don't remember, man. I don't remember saying that. But the plan is to bring these words on paper to life and tell a story. You know, that's what I feel I am, first and foremost, a storyteller.
Well, speaking of bringing words from the page to life, I noticed that not since Bamboozled have you been sole screenwriter on any of your films. You tend to work with other screenwriters or other screenwriters write the film for you. What is it about the collaborative element of screenwriting that's appealed to you for the last 20 years or so? Can you imagine what might impel you to once again take a solo screenplay?
Well, I have solo screenplays, just I have not been able to get those fine yet. Mm-hmm. So it's not like I stopped writing. And with the films I've done, the joints I've done in, you know, in past, the script's very good. I'm not just gonna say, "Oh, I'm not doing this because I didn't write it."
Sure.
You know? So it's never gonna be like that.
Could you talk a little bit about your collaboration with the screenwriters? I mean, you work with quite a few different ones. I guess there have been a few regulars like Kevin Wilmot, but also there have been some sort of one-offs. Do you take a sort of similar approach each time to the screenwriter, or is it a very different kind of collaboration with each project?
Well, I mean, when you work somebody, that's not a guarantee you work with them for the rest of your life.
Mm.
So everything is fluid. You know, there's no like, well, work on this one. We're going to, you know, automatically work with something together. It's not like that. And also, I said before, people have their own schedules.
Mm-hmm.
So no lifetime contracts.
Sure. Well, let's talk a little bit about the double dolly shot. So this is a shot that you've said that you didn't invent, but certainly become a very distinctive, very recognizable element of your films. Where did you first come across the double dolly shot?
I'm glad you said that. I did not invent that shot. I think we came with the term double dolly, but it was with Ernest Dickerson again. We did, the first time we did it was in Mobetta Blues, and it was just something to do. But then Ernest and I made a decision that we can't use this shot unless it has something specifically where we are in that moment and not just doing it for the heck, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So we made that decision was on Malcolm X.
Yeah, that scene where he's walking towards
the
Audubon Ballroom.
When on his way to Audubon Ballroom. And I got to know Dr. Betty Shabazz as Malcolm's widow very well. And she told me that she felt her husband, Malcolm X, knew he was going to be assassinated at the Audubon Ballroom, that to be a martyr. So when she told me that, I told Ernest, and right away we said, we have to use a double dolly shot there. And with the accompaniment of that great song, "Change Gonna Come" by Sam Cooke, I think that's probably the best use of the double dolly shot since we started to do it.
Yeah.
There been time that I thought I could last for long.
It's certainly probably the most famous in your filmography. Do you remember where you first saw the shot in cinema before your films? Do you remember seeing it in any movies?
Oh yeah, as I said before.
Which movies do you remember seeing it?
I don't remember. I saw it in, Ernest and I saw it in film school, where we've seen a whole lot of films. I cannot remember the first time I saw it, but I've been on record saying, I did not invent that shot.
Sure.
But it's, you might say it's like a calling card.
Mm-hmm.
So now people anticipate seeing that shot in my films.
What would you say have been your most misunderstood films?
Well, two. The first one was Do the Right Thing.
Hold up! Time out!
where it premiered in Cannes, and several American journalists, I don't even want to call them journalists, mm-hmm. writers, started this campaign that this film, Do the Right Thing, when it got released in the summer, in June, would incite African Americans all across the nation to riot. Mm-hmm.
That was one film that was sorely
misunderstood. The other film is, I would say, Jungle Fever, that the film was saying that interracial marriages should not happen, which is not the case at all.
She's white. No shit, yeah, she's white.
For me, the most important message in Jungle Fever was that this crack epidemic was wiping out generations of black and brown people.
Either way, I'm gonna get high.
And many years later, we're still dealing with the after effects of that.
Mm-hmm. Another film that I think maybe was sort of not understood very much at the time, but I think has aged pretty well, is Bamboozled. Mm-hmm. Very complex film. Do you want to talk a little bit about what people made of it at the time, and whether you think that that was a kind of misunderstood film when it came out, and if so, why people might have got the wrong end of the stick or not understood what you were trying to do with it?
You know, I don't really worry about that, because people are going to think what they think anyway. Mm-hmm. And people might have their own perception of who I am before the film is. So I know what I'm trying to do. I know the story I'm telling. And sometimes with the example you chose for Bamboozled, you know, they don't get it right away. Mm-hmm. But eventually, Spike was right, what he said back then. Mm-hmm. 25th hour, people would understand that. And now, I mean, you know, people speak of that film highly. So, you know, not to brag, I just think that we're ahead of the curve, you know, in discussing these issues in these films.
With the onslaught of the internet, video, and interactive games, 900 channels to choose from, our valued audience has dramatically eroded.
Around 25 years ago, you began to be quite a prolific documentary maker. Did it make you learn anything about yourself as a filmmaker, or in fact, as a person?
Filmmaking is filmmaking. So in my mind, I never had these distinct blocks. You're a narrative filmmaker. You're a documentary filmmaker. You're a commercial director. You're a director of short films. Mm-hmm. For me, it's all filmmaking, and the way I see filmmaking is telling stories. So in my mind, I don't have these strict restrictions with the different aspects of filmmaking, different genres.
You've said that whether it's making ads, whether it's making music videos or features, whatever it is, your aim is to tell a story. Mm-hmm. Which music videos are you most proud of, especially in terms of things where you think video has told real story?
I would like to say, the late, great Michael Jackson told me, Spike, don't use the term music videos. Mm-hmm. So I'm telling you that.
All right.
Short films.
Short films.
The names, some off the top of my head, the long form version of Fight the Power, mm-hmm. The two versions of the Michael Jackson short film. One we shot in the United States, and the other one we shot in Rio de Janeiro and Bahia. They don't really care about us. Mm-hmm. The other one I did for Prince, Money Don't Matter, Anointed by Nature.
Yeah, that was a fun one.
I've been blessed working with these great, great musicians, Miles Davis, Anita Baker, and these are individuals who saw my work and reached out to me.
Yeah.
When Michael Jackson called me, I hung up on him 3 times because I didn't believe that was him on the other line. So it's an honor and a privilege to work with these great artists.
Mm-hmm. What was it like working with Miles Davis?
Well, Miles Davis has a reputation. Mm-hmm. And he'll call you a motherfucker the second he sees you. But I walked on and said, Spike, I have too much respect for your father, so I won't call you a motherfucker. You know, my father's a jazz bassist.
Yes. So, did they ever work together?
No, but he knew my father. my father's work. That was a big moment for me that Miles knew who my father was and respected him too.
That's huge. What was it like actually working with Miles Davis?
I did what he told me to do. I was in awe, to be honest. I was in awe.
You've worked with so many musicians over the years, Stevie Wonder being another one, and that was an extensive collaboration on Jungle Fever.
Yes.
Could you talk in a little bit of detail about that working process? I mean, how it came about and the sort of day by day of working with Stevie Wonder on that soundtrack.
Well, Stevie is a cinephile. Mm-hmm. He goes to films. He'll have someone describe to him what's he needs, what's on the screen, but he's listening.
His songs are so cinematic. Inner Visions, full of that kind of.
Inner Visions is one of my favorite albums of all time. Mm-hmm. I've always loved that song, Living for the City.
Mm-hmm. That was in Jungle Fever, right?
Yes. A boy's born in hot down Mississippi. And I keep a catalog in my mind of songs like One Day I'm Gonna Use This in the film. Mm-hmm. And Living for the City was one of those songs. And it takes place in the Taj Mahal, this den of crackheads. Mm-hmm. And then, not only had that song, but I wanted Stevie to write all the songs in the film. And a lot of people warned me, like, Stevie's notoriously slow. He'll never make the deadline, but Stevie came through. Mm-hmm. And also, Stevie sang in my wedding, Ribbon in the Sky. Mm-hmm. So there's always been great love between us.
Yeah. How did the songwriting for the Jungle Fever soundtrack happen? Did you sort of play him the dailies, the rushes, and then
we showed him the cut. I mean, we showed him a cut of the film.
Okay.
And he wrote the songs. Mm-hmm.
And they were all written after you'd shown him the...
Yes, it wasn't like a case where he's pulling stuff out of the vault. You know, they were all new compositions.
Okay. I'm going to ask you a really difficult question now. Mm-hmm. Prince or Michael Jackson?
I'm not going to make that choice. I love both of them, and it was an honor for me to work with both of them. Mm-hmm. My relationship with Prince was closer than with Michael, but I'm blessed to work with those two, and it's, mm-hmm. I still shake my head that they're not here.
What are some of your
in
favorite...
In their physical sense.
Yeah.
But...
Musically, spiritually.
Spiritually, they'll always be with us.
Mm-hmm. What are some of your favorite Prince stories?
Well, you know the guitar that has like the thing like that? Mm-hmm. I asked him one time, can I have a guitar? Can you please give me a guitar? Prince looked at me like I had three heads. So when we asked him that again, and then a year later, this big guitar case shows up at my house. And it was the guitar I asked for a year before.
Amazing.
When I saw him later and said, can you sign it for me? I said, Spike, I'm not signing that guitar. If you ask me again, I'm taking it back. I'm gonna ask you again.
I want to also ask a little bit, I mean, we'll talk more about music shortly because it's a big part of your life and
yes. There's
lots of questions I have about it. But outside of music videos, or should I say short films, mm-hmm. You've also done a lot of adverts. Are there any adverts that you were particularly creatively fulfilled by where you felt, I've managed to tell a story and I'm really proud of my work here in this ad?
It would have to be the Michael Jordan Mars mm-hmm. Blackmon commercials would scent Nike into the stratosphere.
However, it's easy to cover Mars Blackmon.
Those had the most impact. Mars came from She's Gonna Have It, the character I played in that movie. And two executives, Jim Riswell, Bill Davenport, of the advertising agency, White and Kennedy, they had the Nike account. They saw the film, and it is their brilliant idea to pair Mars with Michael. They called me up, said, we love your movie, love that character Mars, we want to be in black and white. you play Mars, and you could direct it too, but there's one catch. Michael's not seen, she's gonna have, doesn't know who you are. And many years later, I finally got enough courage to ask Michael, why did you choose me? I'd never done a commercial. And this is my first feature film. He wouldn't answer. I asked him again, he said, well, motherfucker, you wearing my shoes? So I had the honor of being called a motherfucker more than once by the GOAT, Michael Jordan.
I want to ask a question about your most recent big sort of fiction feature, which is The Five Bloods. One of the things that surprised me about it was that it ends with such a sort of a sense of narrative and emotional closure, which is, in a sense, quite unusual for your films, which often leave things very open-ended or on a very ambiguous note. Mm-hmm. So was there a particular, I mean, what was in your mind when you thought, I'm going to give these characters some level of closure and also the viewers some level of closure?
Well, I don't know about your statement saying that all my films I've done, you know, are left interpretation.
No, not all, not all.
But the best way I can answer your question, sir, is that the main goal was to demonstrate black people have been fighting for the United States forever. Mm-hmm. The first person to die in the war between England mm-hmm. and the so-called colony was a black man, Crispus Attucks. So this is not new. And you look at the history of cinema, American cinema, we get left out of many war movies. Like, we did not participate, we did not fight, we did not die for this country, which is a total falsehood. So that was the number one goal. Once again, show that we fought for this country and still denied rights as American citizens. And fast forward to today, including brown people, black and brown people being shot down left and right by the police. So we had this irony where we fight for this country, we love this country, but the country we love kills us. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Today.
You couldn't kill me, man, with three tours. You sure the fuck can't kill me now.
So recently, as you may or may not know, we conducted a major poll, a poll that we do every 10 years, of the greatest films of all time. So every 10 years, we reach out to both critics and directors, and we have two separate polls. Our critics poll, we invited 1,600 critics and curators from around the world. And for the directors poll, we got responses from nearly 500 directors. In both polls, one film in particular did really well, a film called Jean Dielman, a 1975 film by Chantal Ackerman. So that actually came top of the critics poll, and it came number 4 in the directors poll. Have you seen this film?
No.
Have you heard of this film?
No.
Are you more interested in seeing this film now you know that it's been voted for by so many people?
Not really.
Are there any great films that come to mind, just off the top of your head, as some of the greatest films of all time, according to you? Without taking that question too seriously or being too sort of rigorous about it, what comes to mind first?
On the Waterfront, directed by Bill Gazan, screenplay by Bud Schulberg.
Bud Schulberg being someone that you've written a screenplay with?
Yes, we co-wrote a screenplay called Save Us, Joe Louis, mm-hmm. about the boxers, Joe Louis and Max Schmeling, their friendship and the fights, the two fights they fought. In particular, the second fight, many, many people thought that whoever won that fight would determine the outcome of World War II. Mm-hmm. FDR summoned Joe Louis to the White House mm-hmm. before the second fight. And Hitler and Goebbels, to them, Max Schmeling would be an example of the truth of Nazi Germany being the master race.
Mm-hmm. How are we doing with this film?
Still haven't got it made yet, but it's gonna happen. I promise, Bud, we're gonna make it.
Okay. In this poll that we did, 1,600 critics, your film, Do the Right Thing, placed number 24 in the mm-hmm. greatest films of all time. Mm-hmm. But Malcolm X, which is widely considered to be your opus, didn't make it. Is that a surprise to you? And
I don't really care.
You don't care? Yeah, fair enough. Why do you think Do the Right Thing has still today striking such a nerve? Because a lot of your films talk about issues that are still relevant today. Mm-hmm. What do you think it is about Do the Right Thing that really not just caught a nerve at the time, but still resonates today?
You told the truth.
Mm-hmm. It begins with the words, wake up, right?
Wake up, wake up, wake up, wake up. Up you wake, up you wake, up you wake, up you wake.
And also, School Days ends with the words, wake up, which is the film before.
Wake up!
I'd like to get your opinions on New York films, great New York films. There's obviously the usual suspects. There's yourself, there's Scorsese, there's Abel Ferrara. What are some of the great New York
you
films?
You can't even have Sidney Lumet.
What's that, sorry?
Sidney Lumet.
Sure, there are many, but I guess I'm curious for you as a New Yorker, what are the kind of greatest portraits of New York that people don't really talk about enough?
There's so many films, but the film that was very special to me is Dog the Afternoon. Mm-hmm. Before we did Inside Man and pre-production, I screened Dog Day 3 or 4 times to the crew and the cast. Sidney Lumet, I think, is overlooked with this filmmaking. So as homage to Sidney, we did two things. I found the actress who played a hostage in Dog Afternoon, and she played a hostage in Inside Man. She was an actress that Clive Owen told her to take her clothes off to change. She wouldn't do it. In both Dog the Afternoon and Inside Man, pizza is delivered to the hostages. We found the actor who delivered pizza to the hostages at Dog Day. And if you look closely, if you look at the pizza box, it's from Sal's famous pizzeria. So we tied that all up. Or tied it all up. Got to give love to my brother, Martin Scorsese. My mother took me to see Mean Streets, so that had a great impression on me also. I'll name another great film, directed by Billy Friedkin, The French Connection.
Yeah.
That chase scene in the subways, the stop where he got on the subway, that was the stop for my high school. John Dewey High School in the Coney Island. So that scene where Gene Hackman is chasing the subway, to me, that's one of the greatest chases I've ever seen. And also, they didn't have a permit to do that. They just went out and stole that shot.
That was just Friedkin's way of operating, right?
He's going to do what he had to do to get the shot.
Yeah. Yeah, he had that kind of devil may care attitude throughout the whole most of his career, really, and that 70s string of masterpieces is just incredible.
I remember waiting in line for 2 hours in the freezing cold for The Exorcist. And I got to meet him too, so we had a very nice conversation.
Nice.
And he signed my French poster, my French Connection poster.
Okay, so you didn't get the signature from Prince, but Billy Friedkin obliged.
Well, I got a lot of stuff signed. I collect. Spielberg has signed a bunch of posters for me. Godard signed Breathless poster for me. Also signed by Jean-Paul Belmondo. Bertolucci signed a 1900 poster for me. Federico Fellini signed for me. La Strada, Dolce Vita, 8.5. The giant, bigger than the 8 sheets.
You've said in the past that you grew up in a household where your mum loved cinema, loved movies, and your dad was really not a Hollywood fan.
Did not like Hollywood films at all.
Was there any kind of movie he did like? What was the first?
He didn't go to movies. Well, his big thing was sports, so he was taking me all the games. And my mother, I'm the eldest of the siblings, so I was my mother's movie date.
But your dad's worked on your films, right? And he's actually starred he was in School Days, right?
No, She's Gotta Have It.
Sorry, She's Gotta Have It.
But my father did the scores for all my films at NYU Graduate Film School, and She's Gotta Have It, School Days, Do the Right Thing, Mo' Better Blues.
Are there any jazz records that you remember having a really big impact on you, either as an artist or as a person, or changing the way that you saw the world?
John Coltrane's Love Supreme. Mm-hmm. We use that in Mo' Better Blues.
Mm-hmm. What about Miles Davis? What kind of what's your favorite period of Miles Davis's career? Do you have one?
I like the pre-electronic era.
Okay.
I mean, and my Kind of Blue. I mean, that's my favorite Miles Davis album.
Yeah. Moving on from jazz, maybe you can talk a little bit about visual influences. Are there any visual artists, maybe painters in particular, that have influenced your aesthetic or your approach to art?
I wouldn't say painters.
Any visual artists?
I would say, you know, Gordon Parks, Roy DeCaravar, Irvin Penn, Richard Avedon, you know, they all have...
Could you talk a little more about how, I guess, how they changed your approach to the world, the way you saw the world, or...
It didn't change it, just, I would say, enhanced it, you know, and just see how they, with their still camera, how they could tell stories. You know, the picture's not moving.
Jumping back to music briefly, I remember you've said that Summer of Sam was the first time that The Who licensed a couple of their songs from Who's Next, Baba O'Reilly and Won't Get Fooled Again, for use in a movie. How did you persuade them?
Commercials either. Commercials too. I mean, just licensed,
just
period.
Generally commercially. How did you persuade them to?
I made the request and they said, okay. Now, ABBA, they I think there was a back and forth between that for the song,
right.
Dancing Queen.
Yeah.
So they just wanted to know how the song would be used and what type of film it is.
Because their music, I mean, ABBA's music in Summer of Sam is used to counterpoint some really dark stuff.
There's a fucking psycho killer out there killing people.
I don't give a shit. Get the homie fucking killed. You get the fuck out of my car.
It is my car. I will not get out. You get the fuck out.
Get the fuck.
So were they were okay with that?
Yeah. It's in the film.
Yeah.
I mean, if it wasn't okay for it, it wouldn't be in the movie.
But as in, so they asked questions, but they were fine with your answers. They just wanted you to be, I guess you were quite straightforward about how you wanted to use it.
Whatever criteria need to be met, I met it, and it's in the film.
Zooming back a bit, let's talk a little bit about Hollywood and bigger systems. There's an old saying, I'm sure you're familiar with it, that Hollywood isn't black or white, it's green. What do you make of the fact that, I mean, as the platforms and as the finances available to black filmmakers grow and grow, is there a danger that, I guess, more radical, important messages just get co-opted into the sort of content strategies of the Hollywood system?
Well, you're gonna have that. You always gonna have that danger that the story will get co-opted. But I've been on record for several years saying that a lot more people working in the industry behind and in front of the camera, but we're still not at that day where everything was equal. That the equality is there, particularly for black women.
You mean you're talking about behind the camera and at like
both
a producer level?
In front of and behind the camera.
Do you feel things have changed meaningfully? I mean, obviously there's a lot of black films out there at the moment, but there have also been periods in time, you know, in the 90s, for example, where people were saying, oh, look, there are so many African-American films that are coming out. This is really heartening. What's your kind of take on that? Because obviously it's kind of ambivalent. On the one hand, and you deal with some of this, I suppose, in Bamboozled, on the one hand, you've got this increased visibility, but on the other hand, it's sort of part of a commercial machine, and it's sort of, there's a fight to stop it just from being used.
It's two steps forward, one step back. And it's gonna be a constant battle. And until black and brown people get in the room where those gatekeepers decide what we're making, what we're not making, is not gonna be constant. Because you do have these, every 10 years it seems like there's a wave, and the art newspapers writing about this new wave of black cinema, and then the next 9 years, nothing happens, and it comes up again. So I think, I know that as long as we have this feast of famine way of doing stuff, is we're not gonna get the best of what could be as far as these black and brown voices in front of and behind the camera. You've gotta be in a room with those gatekeepers and have a vote.
Do you feel that's changed much, like substantively?
No. My analogy is this. When Barack Obama put his hand on Abraham Lincoln's Bible, there is this terminology called post-racism. Like, just that act of Obama placing his hand on Abraham Lincoln's Bible, hocus pocus, race will be gone. And then you see what happened. I feel, in response to 8 years of a black man in the White House, was Agent Orange. I don't say the guy by his name. So I was definitely, that's how Agent Orange capitalized on sentiment. And we saw what happened January 6th at the Capitol building.
What does truly subversive cinema look like to you?
Tell the truth.
Are there any examples of recent films where you think that's really subversive, that's really radical, that's really dangerous?
I wouldn't use the word dangerous. I don't, why? Something's wrong if telling the truth is dangerous.
Well, dangerous to certain parties that might want to keep things as they are.
Well, I'm not worried about them because their job is to suppress the truth.
Any particular films that have excited you recently?
I've been in the woodshed. I've been in the editing room for over a year on my new documentary on Colin Kaepernick. So I have not really time to look at all the screeners I've gotten.
Sure.
I'm going to vote and I'm going to do my best to see films which I'll be interested in before I vote. I'm an Academy member. And I do vote.
You've also worked with on a lot of concert movies, David Byrne's American Utopia being your most recent effort in that regard. Are there any other musicians, or which other musicians are you keenest to work with in that way in future?
There are a lot, too many to name, but I love music, and I think it's pretty evident with the use of music in my films, songs and score. So a very different taste. I mean, look at He Got Game. Many people told me that having a film that features Public Enemy and Aaron Copland was like, it's crazy, but I knew that it would work.
Which actors are you most keen to work with now? And if you could choose one actor from the past that you never got to work with, who would it be?
Well, from the past, it would be Marlon Brando. I'm still looking for my fifth film with Denzel Washington.
Anyone else that you've never worked with that you think that's an actor I need to work with?
Too many to name, but to answer your question again, I would love to get the final film to complete those, because I think it's not complete with Denzel. Mo Better, Malcolm X, He Got Game, The Inside Man. So I'm looking for that fifth film.
Spike, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Pleasure here. Thank you.